Hello and welcome to this channel. In this video we will revise polymyositis and dermatomyositis. Polymyositis and dermatomyositis are autoimmune inflammatory conditions affecting both skeletal as well as smooth muscles. Proximal skeletal muscle involvement is more common and patients therefore usually present with features of proximal muscle weakness. Among smooth muscles, cardiac and gut smooth muscles are commonly affected muscles. Along with muscle involvement, characteristic skin changes also occur in dermatomyositis. Both diseases, but mainly dermatomyositis, may be a paraneoplastic phenomena commonly from lung, pancreatic, ovarian or bowel malignancy. Therefore, these patients shall be screened for cancers as well. Furthermore, both these conditions can occur in isolation or maybe in association with other autoimmune conditions like SLE and scleroderma. This is a very rare disease. Incidence is 2 to 10 cases per million per year. Age of onset is usually 40 to 60 years of ages. Coming on to clinical features. There is an insidious onset of progressive, symmetrical, proximal muscle weakness, usually affecting the lower limbs more than the upper. Patients report difficulty rising from a chair, climbing stairs, and lifting, often though not always with muscle pain. Respiratory or pharyngeal muscle involvement causes dysphagia, dyspnea, or respiratory weakness and can lead to ventilatory failure or aspiration that requires urgent treatment. Extramuscular features include fever, fatigue, and weight loss, which are most common symptoms in both of these conditions. Other symptoms may include arthralgia and Raynaud's phenomena. Interstitial lung disease occurs in up to 30% of patients and is strongly associated with the presence of antisynthetase, also known as anti-JO1 antibodies. Myocardial involvement causes myocarditis and arrhythmias. Dermatomyositis is myositis plus skin changes. The typical skin changes in dermatomyositis are as follows. Gautran's papules, these are scaly, erythematous or violaceous psoriasiform plaques occurring over the extensor surfaces of metacarpophalangeal, proximal interphalangeal or distal interphalangeal joints and may be seen on elbows and knees as well. These papules are pathognomonic if present with raised creatinine kinase and muscle weakness. Heliotrope rash is lilac purple rash on eyelids in combination with periorbital edema. Nail fold erythema is common due to dilated capillary loops. Shawl sign is macular rash in a shawl-like distribution over the upper back, chest and shoulders. Although the diagnosis may be straightforward, but the differential diagnosis that needs to be considered include carcinomatous myopathy, inclusion body myositis, muscular dystrophy, polymyalgia rheumatica, endocrine and metabolic myopathies, for example, myopathy associated with steroids use, rhabdomyolysis, certain infections, for example, HIV, and myopathies associated with drugs like penicillamine, colchicine, statins, or chloroquine. Coming on to the diagnosis of the disease, serum levels of creatinine kinase are typically raised and are a useful measure of disease activity. Although a normal creatinine kinase does not exclude the diagnosis, particularly in juvenile myositis. Other muscle enzymes, for example, lactate dehydrogenase, aldolase, alanine transaminase, and aspartate transaminase are also raised in plasma. Electromyography shows characteristic fibrillation potentials. Muscle biopsy is the confirmatory test and shows the typical features of fiber necrosis, regeneration, and inflammatory cell infiltrate. It is also helpful in excluding mimicking conditions. Occasionally, however, a biopsy may be normal, particularly if myositis is patchy. So MRI should be used to identify areas of abnormal muscle for biopsy. MRI shows muscle edema in acute myositis. The usual autoantibodies associated with polymyositis and dermatomyositis include anti-Me2 antibodies and anti-JO1 antibodies. Anti-JO1 associated disease is associated with acute onset and interstitial lung fibrosis is associated. That should be treated aggressively. Screening for underlying malignancy should be undertaken routinely, and workup includes a full examination, chest X-ray, serum and urine protein electrophoresis, CT scan of chest, abdomen and pelvis. Prostate specific antigen should be included for men and mammography in women. Coming on to treatment, oral glucocorticoids are the mainstay of the initial treatment of polymyositis and dermatomyositis. Start prednisolone in a dose of 1 mg per kg daily. Sometimes high dose pulsed intravenous methyl prednisolone in a dose of 1 gram per day for 3 days may be required in patients with respiratory or pharyngeal weakness. If there is a good response, glucocorticoids should be reduced by approximately 25% per month to a maintenance dose of 5 to 7.5 mg per day. Although most patients respond well to glucocorticoids, many need additional immunosuppressive therapy. These shall be used early in resistant cases. Methotrexate and mycophenolate mofetil are the first choices of many, but azathioprine and cyclosporine are also used as alternatives. In clinical practice, rituximab is an option for use with glucocorticoids to maintain an early glucocorticoid-induced remission. Intravenous immunoglobulin may be effective in refractory cases. Hydroxychloroquine, mepacrine, and topical tacrolimus are used for skin disease. Thanks for watching. Please like this video, share with your colleagues, and subscribe to this channel.